And we're back. We're here with Nadia Bruce, and she has ink art. And while we're here, go down below in the YouTube and hit like, subscribe. And if you put subscribe and ask for notifications, you can get every single one of our videos. And we are doing a new format. Those of you that are used to watching the whole 1 hour thing each week, we will have an hour, but we're going to split it up in two parts. So you can watch while you're putting your feet up right after work and then come the next night. And plus, I think our producer over here is going to put some of those sound effects and all that appropriate. Maybe I'll get some applause sometime. might if I'm good, right?
Yeah, only if you're good.
Only if I'm good. Well, if I'm not good, gotta be good at it, right?
Yes.
So we're back here with Nadia Bruce, and we talked a little bit on the other show about how she got into her art, and we're going to continue to look at some of her art, and she brought plenty for us to see. 30 minutes. I'm going to mention once again who is our guest next week, and it's Beth Spencer, and she's one of the organizers of the Tuned In Radio Quilt Contest that's going to be at the Tuned In Radio Music and Arts Festival, and that will be June 11 to 13. Start making your mini quilts, start getting your stuff together for that. Plan on being there because, man, it is going to be exciting. I'm put in charge of some scavenger hunts, and we've got all kinds of things coming up. Tickets are on sale now, so go and get them, and they'll only go up, so you got to get your tickets quick.
Get them while they're hot.
We heard a rumor that she's going to be in the artist tent, and here's Rick just came in, so he's going to see her art and see why I think she needs to be in the tent.
Well, I'll apply, of course.
She's applying.
He has the right to curate his own show.
So, okay, we're gonna look at this next one here.
All right, I have another. This is a ink and watercolor piece.
Oh, okay, so the red is the watercolor.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm gonna do this without slamming it.
Again,
is that good angle?
Oh yeah, she's in.
Well, thank you.
She's in. He looked at one picture and said, "You're in."
Oh yeah.
The watercolor is a wash. At this point, when I was learning watercolor, I wasn't brave enough to put the watercolor over my drawing. So I would just put watercolor on paper and see what happened and then draw over that. So this was one of those pieces where I was inspired by this pure red and needed it on paper. And then I also have a tree. I'm a tree lover. I'm a tree hugger. I love trees. And you'll find I do.
She loves trees and cabins.
Ink.
Yeah, and ink. Yeah, we've already talked about her ink on the first half.
So birch trees are really beautiful, and I loved that red is not a color you would expect with birch trees. So this is kind of an ironic and bold version of one of my favorite trees.
So is this one of your earlier things?
Yeah, I think that's maybe 2017, something like there. Before I decided to pursue art full-time, but...
So were you still working at the bank then?
Yeah, yes I was.
Okay, so you haven't been out of the corporate world too long.
No, I put in my notice in 2019, actually. So I was doing art on the side, starting to build it up, but I didn't bite the bullet until summer of 2019.
And then COVID came.
True. Then I had to stay at home and make art.
Well, that's gorgeous. Okay, let's get this over there and get your next one. And
another. This is kind of a cross between the architecture and but this one is all ink, with the colored latex inks.
Colored latex ink
on the background.
Which, okay, do you brush it on, but you can also use it with the nubs?
Yeah, you can dip into an inkwell and use it like a pen, or you can use it with a brush. It's very versatile. You water it down enough, it can even act somewhat like watercolor. It's obviously it's different, a different medium, but you can paint with it, you can draw with it.
Well, Wanda, since we're not doing the live tonight, I'm going to have to show you this when it gets uploaded, the YouTube gets uploaded.
Yeah, make sure to describe it for the audience. This is the piece is a lighthouse with a very vibrant like aurora borealis effect in the background. I called this one Sailor's Delight. If you remember the old saying, you know, red sky at night, Sailor's Delight, and the red sunset and the lighthouse. Lighthouses are always inspiring. They're a beautiful piece of architecture, and if I can blend, you know, a technical item with an organic piece of nature, I really like those combinations. So,
you want to buy this one, Gabe?
I just might.
We'll change it up a little bit.
Oh, look at the stars! Did you see the stars? Mm-hmm. I didn't see that till I turned it this way. Wow!
You flick the white ink.
Yep.
Flick it on there. The old toothbrush.
Mine would be globby, probably.
An old toothbrush. It's a great tool.
Oh, okay.
This is a little bit different style.
This is one you brought yesterday.
Oh, yeah.
Saturday, I got to see this before she got her frame.
Kind of an Art Nouveau phase. I have a series of these that are all mythical and like Greek gods and goddesses. This is a picture of Persephone. I named it the Daughter of the Harvest. You know the story of Persephone. You know, half of the year she was with her mother and in nature, and the other half of the year she got tricked or chose to live in Hades because she ate seven pomegranate seeds, so she had to stay there for 7 months of the year.
Tip it back a little bit.
This way?
Yeah, a little more. Okay.
And this one is ink and watercolor. The Art Nouveau structure is the metallic inks, and she is all watercolor. I loved making new effects with watercolor and ink together. This background, this kind of knurled background, is a combination with salt. So when you lay while the paint is wet or while the ink is wet, you throw table salt on it. And during the drying process, as the salt melts into the water, it forces the pigments away from itself. So it creates this beautiful lace effect in the paint.
So did you do the background first and then laid everything else on top of it?
In this case, no. I had some forethought on this one. I had already done the ink drawing. She's also one of the coloring book pages. So a completely just black and white version of her would be available for someone else to create their interpretation, you know, just the line art. As soon as I have the line art scanned, I want to color it. I want to bring it to life. So, yeah, I did the background and carefully working around her.
Wow. That'd be hard to make sure that the salt didn't get on what you didn't want it on.
As long as the paper's dry, the salt won't affect anything.
Oh, wow. I want one of those coloring book pages.
I'd be happy to get you some.
Some? Does that mean I should give me more than one in case I mess up the first one?
We'll get you a variety. We'll get you some other goddesses that you might like. Here's another black and white piece that's pretty personal to me. This one is actually an early piece. It's of a girl sitting on top of an upright piano with her feet on the keys. And I call her Piano Lady, and my mother was a piano teacher for 30 years. And it's one thing that I regret not sticking with is continuing with music. Because once my mother passed away in 2019 as well, and it's one of those things, you know, you always have regrets, but it makes me feel, I made this before that for her, and I didn't get to give it to her.
Oh, that's sad.
But you know, that was her passion, and I feel like, you know, if someone,
it's okay if you
foreshadowed. We all love our mother. you know, that that something that's part of your life is always part of your life. This mm-hmm. piano with this girl. And, yeah. And again, I did it in the kind of a rustic graphic novel style, if you will. It's just pen and ink, lines and dots, and a little rough, but I like that. I like the grittiness of like an old piano in a bar or something, and a pretty girl sitting on top.
An old piano in a haunted house.
That's, yeah, an old piano in a haunted house. That would be, it plays itself.
Yes.
She doesn't need to be behind the keys.
Well,
because
obviously she's playing with her toes.
let's see.
Underground Sound, Cleveland's premier audio and visual source for all your home, auto, and marine needs.
I'm sick of this old radio. I wish I had some digital tunes like my cell phone.
Underground Sound can integrate digital music and Bluetooth flawlessly into your ride.
Oh no, my husband's gonna kill me.
Backup cameras are just one of our specialties. Here at Underground Sound, we carry a complete line of GPS integration, remote starter setups, sound systems, and security packages well within any budget. All the equipment you need to upgrade your auto, boat, home, or RV, and our expert installation is guaranteed for as long as you own your car. With more than 20 years in the industry, we offer a sales and installation experience unlike any other in Bradley or Hamilton counties. Underground Sound is moving to a brand new location at 909 Sahara Drive right here in Cleveland, and we'll be bringing in even more products for you to choose from. We're open from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. Monday through Friday, so stop in for your upgrade today.
Now that's what I'm talking about. I can't believe I could afford this kind of sound quality.
Oh, my husband is so happy. With my new backup camera and his new GPS, everyone is safer and he doesn't get lost anymore.
Underground Sound, making life easier, safer, and a whole lot more fun.
How about this one? We good on time?
Oh, we have 15 more minutes.
Good. This is another technical piece I did.
So when you say technical piece, tell the people on the radio what you mean by technical.
Technical
piece.
Meaning a lot of rulers and compasses.
It's like it was done with a rapidograph.
Obviously, this is the Pripyat Ferris wheel.
Pripyat, yeah.
People aren't aware where Chernobyl. The Chernobyl accident happened, and Pripyat got a ton of radiation, and the entire town is still uninhabitable. And there's this little theme park in the town that had just opened. So it was brand new, and then no one ever really got to use it. And these little dilapidated pieces of equipment are still sitting there, falling apart. And things that are dilapidated or old or abandoned just kind of, you know, give me those tingles.
Who, you?
A friend of mine.
Draw him next. He's dilapidated. I'm just old.
Oh, shush.
A friend of mine actually last year went to Chernobyl, to that place, and photographed it.
Wow.
Yeah. It's just getting to the point now where you can actually get in and do it, but you want to stay there for a few hours.
Yeah, you've got to wear those little badges.
The radiation, like, detectors.
Yeah.
Wow, I got goosebumps from this one now. You old enough to remember Chernobyl when it happened?
No, I was born in 1985. I am one of those millennials, one of those horrible millennials. But yeah, I'm only 35. But I
started to like her too.
So sorry.
She doesn't act like a millennial, okay?
I was blessed to have been raised by, folks that did things an old-fashioned way, you know. So I was taught to sew and taught to, you know, think for myself, read the Constitution, those types of things.
Oh, you're one of the good ones.
I think a good mix of modern and traditional values.
Yeah. But I remember where I was. I think most of us remember where we were. Chernobyl. 9/11, yeah. Kennedy.
9/11, obviously, I remember. I was in ninth grade.
Well, when you're, the feeling you have with 9/11 is kind of what I have with Chernobyl and Kennedy.
Yeah, I remember Kennedy.
Yeah.
Laying in front of the TV set and going.
Were you home with the flu too?
Yeah.
I was too.
Yeah.
That is so strange. Because I was home with the flu.
I was negative 2 months when Kennedy was shot.
Oh my gosh, we're old, Gabe.
Yeah, we are.
Told you.
We suck.
No, we don't suck. We are so good, it's like a fine wine.
Yeah, vintage is in. Vintage is in now.
Yes.
You guys are like on point. Vintage. You're trending.
The vintage, so, all right. It's a nice way of saying we're old.
I digress.
Yeah.
Art. No. This piece is a piece that's a watercolor or ink over watercolor. So again, I did a wash, see what happens.
So you did a blue and yellow wash. Oh, you got a little bit of pink red in there.
I think I'll have an idea of what I'm going for, but I want to see what the paints do. So if I loosely paint a sunset and a horizon line and a water and then see what wants to come out of this. This one became a winter sunrise or sunset. And this one is the latex ink and gel pen for the white highlights, because that's a really fun medium. I think it's Bic gel pens. They're just amazing. Yeah. And a lot easier to control sometimes than white ink or white out or, you know, latex or paint. Having that opaque white in a pen, it's very fun. So this was all the bright highlights are gel, and then all the colors are the paint from underneath. And I just drew the negative space with the ink.
That's beautiful.
I like it.
I know, yes. Very picturesque. I'm from Minnesota originally, if you can't tell from my accent. Yeah. Yeah, sure, you betcha, don't you know?
What'd she just say?
I hope you have a large body of work to bring to the festival. You could probably sell it all.
I do. I'll have to probably bring prints, because...
You will probably sell all of them.
Well, thank you. I think...
Yeah, you probably sell them. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You better bring a bunch of prints.
Well, I'll have to...
Your stuff for the type of people that can be there is... Yeah.
I told you the rules, right? You got to give me my pick first.
Yes, sir. House rules.
I didn't tell her any rules. I didn't know that was one of the rules.
Here is a different style.
Oh, this is neat.
I did a series, and I probably will add to it, of kind of like that pop art meets graphic novel.
That's
1890s
pop, right?
Yeah. I hate to say it, but you know those like Instagram models that like take these artsy pictures? I go, that would look amazing, like as an illustration instead. And so, you know, maybe I'll reach out and be like, hey, would you like me to draw you? Because I like this composition. I just need your permission.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I made a series of these.
So you send them a print because they let you draw, right?
Yeah, like you get a free copy. Just let me use your photo.
Well, let's talk about that. You don't need their permission.
I like to ask. Mm-hmm. I think if I'm going to steal someone's likeness, that they should have a say if I'm going to sell 100 copies of it.
So if you put something on Instagram, you don't have to have permission?
It's called the Fair Use Act.
Ooh.
If they've decided to make it public, they can have no expectation of privacy. But I think the ethical thing to do is to ask. If I did it without asking, I wouldn't sell it. I would just do it for myself.
Yeah, then you got to watch it too.
And it's just for me. You know, you can draw whatever.
If you sell a million copies of that and you walk around with $1 million and stuff in your pocket and stuff, they'll always come after you.
Yeah.
There's always a clause. If I was doing like a commission for someone, or, you know, in the fine print, I can put like, do you want exclusive rights? Do you want to buy the exclusive rights for me? Or, you know, if you don't want to buy the exclusive rights, then I might reproduce this in the future. And they're cool. They sign. We're good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But yeah.
This is beautiful.
There's a series of three of them right now. Different
bold
colors.
So what's the medium on this?
This is all ink. This is latex.
This is all ink, and Liquitex it almost looks ink. Like watercolor part of it.
Yeah, if you water it down and you add a medium to it, you can treat it like another kind of paint. There's just such wonderful pigments in ink that sometimes are hard to achieve with watercolor. The point of watercolor is to have that translucent feel. So, you know, if I wanted pure color, I probably should, you know, pick a different paint. But I love ink, so ink it is.
She's an inkaholic.
Like, I've got it in my skin. Like, that's all I brought for framed art, but I did bring a project.
A project.
I think I mentioned this to you before, that I am slowly working on illustrating a tarot, my own
yes,
tarot.
Yes, I looked at it on, was it on Facebook or Etsy that I saw it?
I post them when I've done another card. I'll post them on Instagram or Facebook just to see, because it's obviously the whole deck has 72 cards, so it's a long project, and I'm slowly working them through in this. This is an artisan journal I got from.
That's cool, and it's
a handmade artist at a Renaissance Fair, and they put the watercolor paper and the vellum in between each page to protect your work. It's very,
oh, wow.
Very nice. But I thought I'd show a couple that are done. Ooh, hit myself in the face. There you go. Might have to hold it kind of funny. I've got a few that are easily showable. This is...
Can you see okay, Gabe?
Yes.
This is the moon card. And traditionally, you know, each tarot card has a few associated keywords, so that when you deal them, you can interpret someone's situation or someone's question about the future or their past with those keywords, and you try to draw something representative like the original cards. And I'm trying to work somewhat in that Rider-Waite style so that it's identifiable to someone else who wants to use the deck, but I also want it to be mine. You know, I'm not going to...
Expensive reading.
So somewhere down the line, you may do smaller prints and in a tarot card size, maybe.
Once they're all done, obviously they'll be made into a playing card-sized deck and sold as a deck. I have started to sell prints of the individual cards because they're each one is a piece by itself. But you know, the end product is a full deck of 72 pieces of art that then someone can use.
I have a question. How large do you make your prints of something like that?
I will scan them at extremely high pixel
That's
count.
How you're doing a scan?
Yeah, and then I do also digital editing on top of that, because you know, a scan of a textured paper, you know, so the print is not an exact copy of the art. It is as close as I can get digitally, but it's a different product, you know.
Probably would do better with a digital camera than a flatbed scanner.
Probably, but I've been doing this myself, and I've only been, you know, I've always done everything myself. I make my own prints in house. I do my own editing in house. I probably do need to invest in some experts.
So, but how big do you make the print? Smaller, bigger, same, or?
I try to stay close to the original size, but I can go, I mean, right now at home without ordering out, I can make prints up to 11 by 17.
Wow. The bigger she goes, the less detail she keeps from the original.
Yeah, so, and obviously I'm making them at this size, which I think is like a 9 by 12-ish size. It'll come, you know, tarot cards are a little bigger than a normal playing card deck,
right.
But, you know, I'll
they'll reduce beautifully.
They'll reduce great. But, yeah, the different cards all will have, you know, a new life, and I will try to make them a close size in the prints. This is the magician card. I decided to make the magician female. I'm trying to be equal opportunity in my deck, but you know, taking some liberties. The magician card is about power and intuition and manifestation. So, like a magician or a sorcerer. They can make things happen.
Can you guys on camera see the detail? It's amazing. Pillars here, the top where they had them, I guess they carved them because they didn't have cement back then.
Yeah, they would. Yeah, I was going for like an ancient like marble ruin, you know, more even more ancient than this ancient magician, you know.
Wow.
Do we have time for one more? All right.
Yeah.
I have a.
Next page. You gotta edit out me too doing all that talking.
It's not on the mic.
So, huh?
This one is the Hermit card, and I went a little. I took a liberty and I kind of like that Mad Hatter situation, and I've gotten a lot of responses that it's like wonderfully creepy. This hooded. Is it a masked person or is it a human-sized rabbit? We don't know. But the Hermit card is actually about introspection, being alone, retreat from the real world.
I love the bark on the tree.
Yeah, so all of these are done with watercolor.
So sometimes when we run out of anything to do, you and I need to make a fabric line together.
Sounds like fun.
Trees and whatever.
Yeah. I would love that. Anything nature-y, you know I'm there.
Yeah.
But, so I've got a lot more to do. I've started doing them in other places in the book, so there's not a lot completed. There's lots of, like, half-done pieces.
Let's see a half-done one.
Well, here's the line work on the Ace of Cups.
Wow.
The Ace of Cups is always about fulfillment, overflowing, abundance, and so the moon falling into a cup and the water spilling out of the cup. I think, it's a wonderful image.
Thank you very much for coming.
My pleasure.
And I'm glad that you came into my life, because I think you're going to be in my life more than just the art, because you know the quilting and all that stuff. And of course you're going to be at the festival with this. And tell the audience again where they can find your art.
I sell most of my prints on Etsy.com. The shop is called Studio at Raven Hill, because my handle on the internet is Lady Raven Hill. Because, again, I'm a cringy millennial. But
DJs is the dark raven.
So Etsy or Instagram, Ravenhill Creations on Instagram, and then my Etsy shop. If there's something not on my Etsy shop that you see on my Instagram, let me know and I can have prints made.
Do you do commissions?
I do commissions, not a lot, I'll admit. I'm a little bit picky. I really need to be inspired by the commission idea so that I can feel enough energy to really give a good product. But yes, I'm happy to do commissions. Actually, most of the commissions I've gotten recently have been house portraits. They'll see my cabins and old Victorian house drawings and they're like, "Oh, draw my house that way."
So you make their house look Victorian.
Oh no, I'll draw their house, but you know, in that pen and ink style, or I'll draw people's D&D characters. We were talking about that earlier. It's an imaginary person that they've never seen, and they want a physical piece of paper to take to their game and be like, "This is my ogre with the giant sword and his green armor." You know, so. But yeah, I've done fine art commissions and fun commissions.
Well, we'll see everybody next week, same time, same station, and we'll have Beth Spencer talking about the Tuned In Radio Quilt Contest. And you got time to make one. It's just small.
Make a little quilt?
A little quilt. The maximum is 100 inches.
When she's done doing a t-shirt design for me.
There we go. I've got a commission to do.
Sweet.
No.
Uh oh.
You also just sold me a ton of fabric for a queen size quilt, so I think I should work on that.
Okay.
Thank you, Gabe.
We shall see everybody. Bye.